Dear friends, we as pastors are glad to welcome you for this online worship service on the Lord's Day of His Resurrection. And let me read these verses as a call to worship before I do the opening prayer. Sing to the Lord, all the earth, proclaim His salvation day after day. Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before Him. Strength and joy are in His dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come before Him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Allowing gracious Heavenly Father, as Thy word says, here we are on this day of Thy resurrection to lift Your name above all the names who over praises, and to say, in Thy dwelling place, we keep gaining strength to face the challenges and every aspect of our life, O Father. And Lord God, on this day of Your resurrection, You have come in our midst again to speak to us through the songs, music, prayers, praises, and also, Lord God, through meditating upon Thy word. Father God, let every aspect of this worship service this morning lift Your name above all the names, O Father. And also, Lord God, You strengthen us through Thy word. So we give You all the glory and honor. And we ask You this in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In opening, let us all sing this beautiful hymn, "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Bible says, "You crown the year with Your bounty, Your wagon tracks overflow with richness, the pastures of the wilderness overflow, the hills gird themselves with joy, the meadows clothe themselves with flocks, the valleys deck themselves with grain. They shout and sing together for joy." We greet you, especially those who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries. Let me call out the names of all those who are going to remember, celebrate, and thank God for their lives. Birthdays, 19th July, Miss Sandhya Christine Theodore. 20th July, Mr. Philip Christopher Samuel. 21st July, Mr. Nathaniel Raja Singh. Mrs. Sashikala Samuel. 22nd July, Mr. Robin Vincent. Mrs.
Vanaja Vimal, Mr. Vigram Raman. 23rd July, Ms. Gracie L. Songat, Mr. J. Jayakumar Rajapandian, Ms. Rebecca Joseph. No wedding this week. Let's look unto the Lord in prayer. Gracious Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord, for this Sunday morning service. With grateful heart we come to you, Lord, along with these dear children of thy grace. We also, Lord, come to your throne of grace, especially lifting all these dear ones to your holy name. You bless each and every one of them. We thank you, Lord, for their lives on the earth. We thank you for the purpose fulfilling through their lives each and every day. Master, this morning, we bless them. We greet them in your holy name. Let thy shalom continue to be among them. They may continue to see the prosperous and also successful years in their lives. You be with them, bless them, Lord, as we go through this deadly disease. I pray in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that they will be completely under the refuge of the holy name of God. And also, Lord, I pray and bless them. They may continue to grow in you, have good health, abundant life, and also rich experiences of spiritual journey. You be with them, Lord, and bless them. Let them continue to see the wonderful years of blessings in their lives. All glory and honor to your name. We pray in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We are privileged to have Jonah and team to lead us in praise and worship.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Just because we are not able to worship in the sanctuary of our Lord, we should not think we cannot worship him at all. Jesus said to the Samaritan woman, "A time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem." God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship him in spirit and in truth. As we sing the first song, Sing for Joy, please get up and sing out loud the simple tune. Our God shall heal the world as we rend our hearts and draw near to him. By the way, singing improves your immune system and defends you from all kinds of enemies. Come, let us sing. Joel 2:13 says, "Rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity." Come, let us sing. Thank you. prayer. Let's sing this song meaningfully to ask our Lord's forgiveness and in the hope that one day we will join the heaven's choir to sing, "Holy is the Lord."
Father, we thank you, Lord, for helping us to praise your name, Lord. Thank you for all that you've done for us in our lives, Lord. Father God, you are a God who is worthy of our praises, Lord. But many a times we fail to really have that worship the way we live our lives, Lord. Forgive us for the times we have run after our own idols, and Lord, for the times we have failed to see your goodness even during the tough times, Father God. Lord, we just pray that you would help us to have a heart that is in complete surrender to you, Father God. As we continue to sing our next two songs, we just pray that you help us to just worship you and give anything that needs to be replaced by you in our life, Father God. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen.
Jesus, our Savior.
Let's spend a few moments in an attitude of prayer. Isaiah 41 verse 10 says, "Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand." With this promise, let's look to the Lord in prayer. Our loving, gracious Heavenly Father, as your word says, yes, we are sure you are always with us as Emmanuel to lift us from all sorts of different, difficult, dangerous situations, O Father. And Lord God, you know how much we are encouraged these days through thy word. If not, O Lord God, like others, we will be in confusion and we will give in to chaos and uncertainties, oh Father God, as we are surrounded by news of death and news of violence and terrorism and news of families not doing well and people losing the job, people going through salary cuts, and here and there, O Father, people who are going through terminal illness, O Father God, wherever we turn around and to whoever we talk, O Father, Lord God, our ears are very much hearing to the words of discouragements, disappointments. In the midst of all these, O Father, your word reminds us not to be afraid, because you are with us and you will not allow us to get weak, tired, weary, disheartened. And Father God, you are constantly at work, as at times even we fail to recognize that your presence is always around us and you are within us. And that is why, O Father, at times we give in for the Satan to have his thoughts and his actions in us. Father God, we also this morning thank you for accepting our praises. And we thank you, Lord God, for enabling us to listen to thy still small voice, even through those songs with what we have lifted your name above all the names. And we can say for sure how much you have strengthened us to bring all our supplications at your feet. And Father God, before that, we confess all our shortcomings. Father God, is you know the intricate things of our life, as nothing is hidden to you, O Father, as you are our God who measure every thought of us, every word of us, and all our actions. Father God, nothing is hidden to you. So cleanse us, purify us, make us worthy, O Father, to live the life what you expect out of us on a given day, in a given moment. And as you have set us apart to keep reflecting your beauty, Father God, nothing else should be seen in us, O Father. So Lord God, you continue to teach us how to humble ourselves, how to keep surrendering every thought of us to say, as the Lord's right hand is upon us, and he will strengthen us to be victorious both in our spiritual as well as in our physical life. And Father God, this morning we continue to pray for those who share their prayer requests with us. And Lord God, you know some of our church members are not keeping well for months, for years, and some are homebound and some are even on the bed. Oh, Father God, we want you to touch them and you heal them, oh Father. And as some of them are even taking treatment for terminal illness, oh Lord Jesus, let thy children continue to experience many miracles in their life, oh Father. So Lord God, we want you to touch all those who are going through some kind of physical ailment. Let thy children say, God has healed me through his stripes. And Father God, we continue to pray for the young mothers. We pray for the couples waiting for a child. We pray for those young people who are yet to know the person of your choice in their life. We pray for those young people who are yet to start their career. And you know the anxiety of the parents too, Lord God, when they see their children still not established in their career and having a family of their own. And Father God, we pray for the plus two children who will be taking every effort to enter into the college level of studies after they come to know about their results, O Father. So Lord God, we pray that let all our children in our church, among our families and relatives who are waiting to get into the university level of studies, guide them with your wisdom. And Father God, we pray for all other children who are still waiting to know how they can complete their college level of studies, particularly, O Father, those children who are in the final semester are having a very big question: how are we going to complete our course and get into the next level of studies or to seek job? Guide them, O Father, with your wisdom. And Father God, we pray for every other material need in every individual's life, in every family's life, O Father, in our church, and also, Lord God, among our friends and relatives. Yes, during this lockdown period, O Father God, you are taking care of the food and the water of each and every one of us, and you are even taking care of our work. And Lord God, even some of our church members who are doing their business are able to, O Father God, revive their business, O Father, after some months of lockdown. O Father God, you provide all the resources what they are in need in order to bring back their business into the shape what they had, O Father. And Lord God, we pray for every other person who is thinking about the future. And you are reminding us, O Lord God, you are holding on to our future. And so, Father God, continue to bless all our members in the Ananaga Methodist Church. And we also pray, O Father, week after week, as we get connected to our people through the online worship services and even by calling some of our people over the mobile, Father God, help us as pastors to know that you are in control over every member of our church, O Father. And Lord God, we also pray at this moment for our churches in Paitishwaran Koil and in Chidambaram. And we continue to pray for Pastor Samuel and for Pastor Obed. Help these, your servants, to minister with great joy and happiness, with enthusiasm, in the midst of so many limitations, oh Father. So Lord God, this is our prayer. Let both the congregations, once after the normal situation returns, we wanted to see all the people gathering and worshiping you with a heart of thanksgiving. And in thy appointed time, you enable us to build thy sanctuary in Chidambaram. And Father God, we pray for our episcopal leaders. Continue to be with our Bishop Dr. E.D. Esaratnam, and with Mrs. Evangeline Esaratnam, and with her entire family, O Father, as they continue to give leadership both in Chennai Regional Conference and in Moradabad Regional Conference. Oh, Father God, grant them wisdom, understanding, and also, Lord God, give them the strength, the energy, and all what they needed, oh Father, to continue with the leadership in both these conferences as well as in the MCI level. And Father God, we pray for all the bishops and the offices at general as well as regional levels. And we also pray for all the district superintendents and for the pastors, deaconesses, for the heads of the institutions and every other person whom you have chosen for the leadership in MCI, O Father. Lord God, as leaders, help us, O Lord God, to conduct the affairs of the church with thy wisdom, O Father. And Lord God, we pray for the expansion of thy kingdom even through the Methodist Church in India. And Father God, let our MCI reflect your holiness and be perfectly placed at the center of thy holy will, O Father. We pray with all humility, with fear and trembling, and in reverence, O Father. And Lord God, we also pray for all the ministries in and around this world. Continue to guide each denominational church, O Father, to keep doing thy ministry with great enthusiasm and not to lose their focus, not to lose the joy of ministering, as we are limited in many ways because of this pandemic and lockdown. And Father God, we pray for the entire world. You know how the entire world is going through crisis after crisis. Lord God, this coronavirus has brought many crises, O Father. It's not only killing people, but also, Lord God, people are dying because of the economic fall down, and people are even dying as they get into psychiatric problem. We see here and there how people are committing suicide and getting into depression and various other sickness, O Father, across the world. O Father God, we stand in the gap and we plead to forgive the wickedness of this world and be gracious upon thy creation, O Father. O Lord God, as the death toll has crossed even 6 lakhs or so, Father God, we pray that you be gracious, O Father, and more than 1 crore of people are affected by this virus. You know, Lord God, even before we utter all these, but still, O Father, we pray that for your grace to be sufficient. And also, Lord God, you know how in our nation of big population cannot withstand this virus when it goes into nook and corner of this nation. So Lord God, be gracious upon our nation as our leaders are continuing to take care of the citizens of this nation. Guide them with your wisdom and understanding, and so that they can guide the doctors, the scientists and the bureaucrats in order to protect the people of this nation, O Father. And Lord God, this morning we thank you for bringing a pastor, Reverend Andrew B. Natarajan, with thy word, as your child will be breaking thy word. Help us to listen to thy still small voice. Continue to anoint him afresh so that every word which comes forth will strengthen each and every one of us, will encourage us, O Father, will enable us to look forward with positiveness and to say, yes, O Lord, our God will help us to see that we will not fall in any aspect of our life and bring dishonor to the name of our Lord. So Father God, let thy word come into our hearts this morning through our pastor and continue to speak to us. We give you all the glory and honor. And we ask you this in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who has taught us to pray, our Father, what in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
We are privileged to have Mrs. Carlin Davis to read the scripture lesson for us in this morning service. I request her to read from Genesis chapter 13, verses 10 to 13.
Today's scripture portion is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 13, verses from 10 to 13. Genesis chapter 13, 10 to 13. Lot looked up and saw that the whole plain of the Jordan was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, towards Zoar. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived among the cities of the plain and pitched his tents near Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord. Here ends the Bible reading. Thanks be to God.
The Lord is good, His love endures forever. I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are privileged children of God to meditate God's word week after week through these online services. For the monthly theme, I hope you all remember that we recited 2-3 times that take heed lest you fall. For today's meditation, the theme is fall of a community. Fall of a community. We are going to see how a particular nation has fallen because of the community sin. And also we are going to see one or two other references, how some other nations also had fallen because of their community sin, or as a community going against the will of God. For that, I would like to base my thoughts from the book of Genesis chapter 13 verses 10 to 13. Just now we heard reading through Mrs. Carlin Davis. In fact, today we are going to meditate about the Sodom and Gomorrah cities. Three spiritual lessons I want to share with you about these cities. One is, Sodom and Gomorrah were wealthy cities. Secondly, Sodom and Gomorrah were wicked cities. Therefore, Sodom and Gomorrah became record cities. So let us see how the wealthy situation turned into wickedness, and how wickedness finally leads to destruction of a city, of a nation, of a community, sometime even an individual. First, we read in Genesis chapter 13 verse 10, we see here that Lot looked about him and saw that the plain of the Jordan was well watered everywhere, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt in the direction of Zoar. This was before the Lord had destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. One more translation very beautifully translate this particular verse, the voice translation. Let me also read that verse. Lot looked around and he noticed the grassy plains in the Jordan Valley looked well watered and fertile, just as he imagined the eternal one's garden might be, or as he knew the land of Egypt in the direction of Zoar to be. This all helped before the eternal destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Here, very importantly, we have to notice three words. One is well watered everywhere. Second one is it was looking like garden of the Lord. Thirdly, it was looking like the land of Egypt. Sodom looked like the garden of God or the garden of Eden. In fact, the word garden, which is translated in our Bible, the original Hebrew word is gan. The gan means the pleasure. The word paradise somewhat came into existence and stands still with the people everywhere. In almost all religion, they believe this particular word means heaven or something which people always look for. The word paradise is neither Hebrew nor Greek. In fact, it comes from the root word from the language of Aramaic. Therefore, the meaning is paradise, in fact, in Aramaic means fruitful, well-watered, pleasurable, sweet place. So the Hebrew translators, they took this word and they referred the word gan as fruitfulness, a place of pleasure. Therefore, here the word of God says, Lot looked about him and saw that the plain of Jordan was well watered everywhere, like the garden of the land, of garden of the Lord. So therefore, the garden of Eden means it was not cultivated, not enwalled garden, but it's an open space. A fruitful trees were covering the all over the plain, and it was very beautiful. In fact, God created, even before he formed man out of the dust, he prepared everything for him and in order to put him there so that he will enjoy his entire life in the Garden of Eden. But the Garden of Eden signifies today a delight and pleasure for people. It was adorned with the trees, fruitful trees, and it was very pleasant to see, and also the fruits were very tasty to eat. That's what we read in Genesis chapter 2 and 3, the creation and fall, that gives us that understanding. Now here we understand this particular concept is always carried in the lives of the people, in the patriarchs, and also in the Exodus community. In all these people, always they remember. Throughout the Bible, if you turn, we'll see again and again these particular words like Garden of the Eden, Paradise, and also sometimes we read about land of Egypt, and we sometimes read about Sodom and Gomorrah. So many occasions, many God children have utilized. We can see that many of them are very often referred to these places. So therefore, here we understand Egypt means wealth, safety, prosperity, and places of horses, and good establishments. And it was a very good kingdom on those days. Therefore, people had more attractions. In fact, Bible wants to show that how Moses did not have attraction towards the Egypt. That's why in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 26 we read Moses chose to be with the children of God, to suffer with the children of God rather to enjoy the pleasures of Egypt. That means Egypt means pleasures, Egypt means enjoyment. So now Lot looked around and he looked at that the place what he was thinking looks like the garden of God, looks like a beautiful well-watered place and looks like as a paradise. So therefore he thought, let me take the offer is given to me, so I have to immediately grasp it. So Lot now separated, after selecting this, he separated from Abraham. We read that in verse 11, so Lot chose for himself all the plain of Jordan and Lot journeyed eastward, thus they separated from each other. This separation is a very phenomenal separation, very, very important to notice, because now he has separated from the godly man, he has separated from the righteous man, he has separated from the man who was called by God, a man who was blessed by God, a man who had the counsel and advice of God. He quickly turned away from that place because he saw that luxurious of that place. He saw only the greeneries, the luxurious and various attractions. And in fact, someone said like this, the Lot did not see the future destiny, only he saw the present pleasure. Now only when we depend upon God, we can understand what kind of destiny we are going to have if we have our own choices of having our own choices in our life. So therefore, without realizing, Lot chose the excellent future. According to the world view, Lot chose excellent future from a worldly point of view, but ruined his spiritual interest with worldly advantage. You know, whatever the vantage we take, that vantage will become disadvantage to us at one point. We all have to be very careful. You know, it's a warning. Warning also here, recorded here in this verse 13, the end ends like this. Thus was before the Lord had destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. That means that warning, in some of the translations they put it in bracket, that means it is known to God. The some of the destinies we may not understand. Those things are bracketed. Those things are close to our eyes. But God can see. God saw that what would be the destiny of Sodom and Gomorrah, but Lot did not see. Lot saw only the grass. Another commentator puts like this, Lot chose green grass for his cattle, but Abraham chose grace for his children. You and I have to be very careful what we choose. Are we choosing for our survival, or are we choosing something for the generations to enjoy the grace of God? Proverbs chapter 14 verses 12 to 14 we read, it says that there is a way appears to be right, but in the end it leads to death. Even in laughter the heart may be in pain, and the end of joy may be grief. You know, the prima facie we have to look into this. You know, any cases come to the police at the court, they'll go for the prima facie. Prima facie means not only you are just looking at and saying that okay, everything is okay, we can take, but you have to see beyond, do the thorough investigation, whether it is a right place for me to go and to be associated, whether it is a right place for me to go and be employed there, whether it is a right place for me to go and be settled over there. All these things we have to do thorough investigation before we do any choices for our life. But here we see that Lot did not do any thorough investigation, though he knew that these people were wicked, because the Bible very clearly writes about that one. Matthew Henry puts like this, those who are guided and governed by the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life cannot expect God's presence and blessing in the choice of relations in marriage and friends, callings, our occasions, dwellings, our housings, our settlements. These self-devised men have no heart in their play, their worship of God. Their souls are not liquid, the flowing out in praise and full of love and heaven for God. There is none of the spirit of heaven in their hearts. They are not really heaven-minded. They are not really God-centered. They are not really Christ-centered. They are thinking about only the worldly pleasures. Therefore, we and I have to be very careful whether we are also caught into these kind of attractions in our life. Psalm 32:8 says that we have to wait upon the Lord to get the counsel and advice for our life each and every day. The realities are not delights for Lot, though he thought that it's going to be a great paradise. In fact, when he reached that, he found it is a great hell. You know, many times for us, when we look something far off, it looks very greenery. But when we go very nearer, we understand the inconveniences, the problems, the disastrous situations we can understand. Therefore, before getting late, we should understand and surrender our lives to the Lord. Because many a times people think about only the wealth, only the richness, only they think about possessions, only they think about some power, only they think about something which is pleasurable. But you and I have to be very careful. The real pleasure comes from the Word of God. The real joy is given by the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The real joy comes by reading the Word of God. When we read the Psalms, when we read the prophetic books, when we see the Gospel, when we see the whole Bible, we understand how pleasure and how beautiful to delight in the Word of God. You know, the Garden of Eden is fenced by God. It was really taken care by God. If you and I think something else as Garden of Eden, that may not be true. You and I have to commit ourselves to the Lord and look for His fencing, His protection, His providence in our life. Psalm 1 explicitly convey this great message that those who delight in the Lord and in His word are like a garden planted by streams of water and yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither, and he does prosper. If you need prosperity in your life, if you want to enjoy wealth in your life, don't look around, only look up. When we look up God, we can get all that we needed for our lives. Dear friends, this morning, let us once again take heed lest you fall. Because the Word of God says, unless we look ourselves, search our own hearts, many a times there is a possibility of fall. Here, Lot went to nearer to Sodom and Gomorrah, and he wanted to give grass for his cattle, but finally ended up in a wicked city. So my second thought from here is Genesis chapter 13, verse 13. Now the people of Sodom were wicked, great sinners against the Lord. Sodom and Gomorrah were wicked cities. With a great contrast we read in the Bible, immediately introducing this place as a beautiful place, well-watered, looked like a garden of the Eden, and looked like the land of Egypt. Suddenly, Bible brings the reality that is now the men of Sodom were wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord. Isaiah 3:9 says, the sin of Sodom was nakedness, and their faces showed it. The gross sin is always referred to as Sodom and Gomorrah. Their wines were wines of sins and filled with poisons. Deuteronomy 32:32, we read about Sodom as a poisonous wine. The beautiful cities became filthy, shameful and wicked cities. Dear friends, we have to be very careful. When we go after the wealth, when we go after the pleasures of the world, we are going to end up with somebody, we are going to end up with something which is going to be abhorring to the Lord, which is going to be denying the Lord, which is going to be hated by God. You and I have to be very careful. Sin means missing the mark or aim in life. Here we see they not only missed the mark, they exceedingly became great sinners. Their wickedness increased day by day. They have broken everything. They destroyed everything. They said there is no distinction between right and wrong. Whatever they were doing, they want to call everything right. You know, the person, whoever goes away from the Lord, he thinks whatever he does is always right. We have to be very careful where we stand and how we evaluate ourselves. When we seek the worldly honors, when we seek the worldly possessions, and we try to gratify, we try to satisfy the sensual gratifications, then we end up in disappointments, affliction, vexation, and ruin, according to Adam Clark. You and I have to be very careful. Benson says like this: Sodomites were impudent and daring sinners who despised and openly defied God. Proverbs 30, verses 8 to 9, there a person known as Achor, he makes two petitions to the Lord. He says, Lord, you never allow me to become a rich man, nor I will become a poor man. Keep me always under thy protection, providence, so that I will not neither become rich nor poor. And when I become rich, I will become very proud and wicked things I will do. If I become poor, I will curse you, Lord. I don't want to go to either end, either extreme. Lord, you keep me always under thy wings. Gill, the commentator Gill, quotes from the Tarkum of Jonathan. He says that the people of Sodom reckons up many of their sins as defrauding of one another in their substance, sinning in their bodies, unclean copulation, shedding of innocent blood, worshipping of idols, and rebelling against the name of the Lord. He quotes from the Tarkum of Jonathan. The Tarkum of Jonathan gives comment or explanation to the Isaiah chapter 3 verse 9 about Sodom. Haggadic tradition of the oral Torah, it says that the people of Sodom, wide possibilities were they were in hospitality, they were in greed, they were doing theft, deception, disregard for the poor and the orphan, and inhumanity. The pinnacle of their sin was mercilessness. The pinnacle of the sin was their mercilessness. They became so cruel in their activities to one another. Lot knew the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah because he was living nearer to them. However, his desire prevailed the purpose and plan of God. Lot so consciously made this evil choice to take up his abode among high wicked people. He made this choice for the pleasing prospect of a convenience for his cattle and of enriching himself. Now Lot looked for the grass for the cattle, as I was quoted earlier. Abraham looked for grace for his children, for his generation. You know, someone said like this: life is sum up of all your decisions. Life is sum up of all your decisions. Lot decided to live among the wicked people. Today, you and I have to take care that where we live today is very, very important for us to go to the presence of the Lord. You know, here, Allah's such a step he took very quickly to go there, and he became very deaf to all the things what is happening around him. And finally, he vexed about the things what is happening. That's what we read in later in 2 Peter chapter 2 verses 7 to 8. I will read once when we come to that passage again. So, now we have to be very careful. The warning comes to us from Jude verse 11. He says, woe to them, they have taken the way of Cain, they have rushed for profit of Balaam's error, they have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. All these three people, they are examples for three kinds of sin: lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and also the pride of life. You and I have to be very careful where we stand today. Are we standing with the community which is thinking that they do all kinds of practice, they do all kinds of sins, telling that in our culture, in our custom, in our country, it is not the sin? You have to be, you and I have to be very careful that where we stand today, with whom we stand in our convictions. Lord saw paradise afar off, but ended up in hell. How often we see many green things afar off, and going closer, we understand the dryness and emptiness in our life. The hypocrites' lives of wicked are as contagious as the most dreadful plague as infects today. Today we know as the coronavirus. Today people use various words like super spreader. You know, sometimes some people are, there are some people who are known as super spreaders. They do all kinds of false things, all kinds of hypocritic things. They leave all kinds of evil footsteps for the people to follow. It's very dangerous. If we follow them, we are going to have certainly doom for our life. Dear friends, check where you stand today. Take heed lest you fall. Please read Genesis chapter 6 verses 5 to 8. When we read, we understand the whole world was indulging in great wickedness during the time of Noah. Every inclination of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil all the time. Very strong condemnation, very strong comment God is giving here. He says that every inclination of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil all the time. The Lord grieved for creating humankind. The Lord grieved for making Saul as king. What about you and me? Whether the Lord is happy about you and me for creating us and keeping us and giving all the blessings, giving all the wealth, giving all the education needed, giving all the prosperity needed for us, or whether God is grieved about our life. He's telling, why I have blessed this man? Why I have created this man? What about you and me? We have to be very careful where we stand today. There was a man known as a man after God's own heart. You know, God is looking for such person in our life. We cannot justify the unjust acts because the world says so. But Jesus told us very clearly, say yes means yes, no means no. Nothing else beyond that will be always sin. Beyond that, there is no truth. The truth has to be plainly told. You know, the tragedy of these five kings of this Pentapolis is the cities known as the five cities which are reading in Genesis 14. They all had an experience with Abraham, the godly person. Because Abraham went and fought with the other kings, the enemy kings, and he redeemed the kings of the Sodom, kings of Gomorrah, kings of Admah, kings of Zeboim, kings of Bela. He brought them all and he talked to them, but they never learned the good habits, the godly fear from Abraham. They continued to live in their wickedness. You and I have to be very careful. How often we read the Bible, we participate in services, we participate in various spiritual programs, but are we still living in the same life, same old pattern, or we have come to the presence of the Lord? Thirdly and finally, I would like to say the later parts of the chapter 13 verse 10. We say that this was before the Lord had destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah. It was the Sodom and Gomorrah became record cities, destroyed cities. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 18 verse 20, we read, it says that then the Lord said, how great is the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah, and how very grave their sin. The outcries have come to the Lord. You know, it is not only they were doing all wickedness, but they were all doing all kinds of injustice to the people. Therefore, the outcries have come to the Lord. What are the outcries? Bible lists from various places. When we read Ezekiel chapter 16, 49, and Isaiah 3, 9, and also we read in various parts, in even 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 7 to 8, we understand what kind of cries were there. We understand the issues, not only the sexual immorality, they also indulge in violence. God heard particularly the cry of the poor among them, whom they suffered to starve. Other sins have enlisted. In Ezekiel chapter 16, 49, it reads like this: now this was the sin of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters were arrogant, overfed, and unconcerned. They did not help the poor and the needy, though there was the fullness of bread in the midst of them. They really were doing all kinds of lawlessness. They had all wealth among themselves, the blessings among themselves. They were not willing to share with the needy people. How often we also shrink to that level? How often we close our hearts, close our purses, close our bank accounts? We don't want to reveal to anybody. We don't want to give to the Lord. We don't want to honor the ministry. We don't want to give to the people when they are in need. Here, this particular act is warned. And also the Jewish rabbis say they appointed false judges who oppressed all strangers that came to Sodom and made a law that whoever relieved a poor person should be burnt alive with fire. Their sins were many and great and openly, imprudently committed. Therefore, the cry of strangers went to the Lord. The cry of the poor went to the Lord. And not only that, they killed many people. Innocent people were killed. The cry of which came into the ears of the Lord of hosts and called for vengeance. The blood of the martyrs, the people who were killed for righteousness. These cities became cities of wickedness. All the five cities, the kings, all of them had only one agenda. The lawlessness became the ruling agenda. How often we all join together sometime to go against God's will. As a community, we have to look into our own lives. As a church, as a denomination, where we stand today, are we at the center of the will of God, or we are doing whatever what we want to do? How often we have justified that whatever is happening in the church, in our denomination, in our election process, we say that it's all right, we can go ahead. Today, you and I are warned by very heavily by the word of God. We need to look into our own lives. Are we standing at the center of God's will? You know, the very beautiful thing Peter wants to bring out from Lot's life is, Lot was a righteous and godly man. He was distressed by the filthy lives of lawless man. He was tormented day after day in righteous soul for the lawless deeds he saw and heard. You know, double standard. A man who lives among the wicked people, who has associated with them. How we understand he was associated? We understand in Genesis 19:1, when the Lord visited, the angels visited the Sodom, he was sitting at the city gate. You know, when the people sitting at the city gate means, in those days, we have already meditated city gates known as the court of that city, court of justice of that city. And also, city gate means the council meets there, the board meets there, the management meets there. He was one of the important leaders of the management now. But how can he tormented within himself, but at the same time, he is also living with them? How often we are also going through these kind of spiritual torment in our lives? We are consciously prickled in our mind that I want to come out of it, but we are not able to do. Today, you and I have to realize that where we stand. Are we standing with the righteous? Are we standing with God? You know the beauty of this particular conversation between God and Abraham. We understand in the chapter 18, they were keep on talking and Abraham was bargaining for 10. The pathetic situation is, God did not see even 10 righteous person in the 5 cities of Zoar. In all these 5 cities, he was not able to see 10 righteous persons. Therefore, God has to destroy that particular, all those cities, the Pentapolis. Dear friends, when Lot went to Sodom, he went with a big cattle, a large number of blessings, and enormous wealth. He went to that place. When we read in chapter 13, because they have to separate themselves because of they had huge property. Therefore, they have to be separated. But now, the unfortunately verse, the chapter 19, when we go to chapter 19, we see that chapter 19 verses 24 to 38, we read that he ran away as a single person, even lost his dear wife and lost the dear children's future, and he was running as a vagabond. Dear friends, it's a great warning for all of us to understand where we stand today is very, very important. When we stand with the wickedness of the community, when we stand with the so-called righteousness of the community, the so-called the community's understanding, you and I have to understand where we stand. We always stand with God. We should always go with God. We always have to be with God. That is very, very important. Adam Smith writes like this: the glare of Sodom and Gomorrah has flanked down in the whole length of scriptural history. The judgment occurred in Genesis, applied in Deuteronomy, then referred by prophets like Amos, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Zephaniah, and Lamentations. And also even in the New Testament, we read Paul talks about Sodom, Peter talks about Sodom, and Lot, and also even Jude talks about this one. Then even Jesus Christ referred to Sodom and Lot. You and I, how we are going to be referred by people in after we go away from this world? Are we going to be referred as the best example to follow, or the worst example not to be followed? You and I are one today. It is very, very important to understand. It is not the presence of evil, but the absence of good which brings the long suffering of God to an end. The judgment of God on a particular nation, on a particular community, on a particular person, if the Lord does not find goodness, he will destroy. Dear friends, this morning, let us once again think, what happened to the Sodom and Gomorrah and all the 5 wealthy cities, you know? Today in the map, when you go to the mosaic map, you understand it's all submerged in the Dead Sea. It became a Dead Sea today. You and I have to be very careful. The wealth, the whatever richness we are enjoying in our life, if it is coming out of wickedness, one day it will be submerged by the curse of God. You and I have to surrender ourselves, look unto the Lord, and once again think that where we stand. Take heed lest we fall. Let us look unto the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord, for this morning. We thank you for thy word. Continue to speak to us, Lord. In the days to come, we will look into our own lives and we will come closer to you. And thank you, Master, for the lessons we learned from Lot and Sodom and all the other cities which were destroyed. You be with us and bless us, Lord. Give us thy grace that we will continue to grow and take heed so that we will not fall in our life. All glory and honor to your name. We pray in the name of our Lord and Savior. In the light of the meditation, what we heard, let us sing together, Stand Up and Stand Up for Jesus, as a closing hymn for this morning service. Let us receive the benediction. Now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God the Father, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all and remain with you all now and forevermore. Amen.
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 Amen.